The aim of today then is one thing and one thing only, really, to get you guys ready to actually do things clinically and treat patients. Yeah, so we've done some points and we will do more points, but what I want to do is to get some protocols going and see how we're actually going to fit things in. So let's just start out with a bit of a sort of a general recap in terms of clinical decision making. So we need to cover these things and look at these things. Which points are we going to choose? Because obviously, you know, we've got 360 points in total. We've done a few, and eventually we'll do 100. So we want to try to avoid getting into this trap of always using the same things. Yeah, I mean, a protocol can be used as a starting point, as a guide, but as healing changes and as pain changes throughout the treatment cycle, so the acupuncture or the treatment, the physio treatment, which will include the acupuncture, has to progress. So which points to choose? Determining the strength of treatment, we've looked at that a little bit and we need to practice that a little bit more. And part of the strength of the treatment will be electroacupuncture, which we won't actually be doing until the second weekend, but again, we can use that in preparation. How to progress and vary the treatment. And I think that's so important, and it's something I think as a profession sometimes, when we're very busy, we're a little bit guilty of. You know, we give the same exercises, the same manual therapy, etc., etc., and really we should be progressing throughout our treatment, and that's particularly the case with acupuncture. And then key is, how are we going to fit the acupuncture into physiotherapy treatment? Because we're not saying let's now use acupuncture rather than physiotherapy. What we're saying is this is another modality, so we need to question and say, well, is this modality more or less effective than what we're currently using, whether it's manual therapy, ultrasound, or whatever we choose? Is it more or less effective on this particular patient for this particular condition? Now, if it isn't, don't use it. Simple as that. If it is, fine, but what's it going to replace? Okay, so this is a very busy chart, but let's just have a look at this, and we're sort of halfway through. So the first, and this is a sort of cycle of clinical decision making, really. The first question we have to ask is, are we going to use needling? Now, if we were an acupuncturist, that's all we've got. But as physios, we've got a lot of other treatments in our toolbox. So we have to be prepared to say, well, no, you know, in my clinical experience, this particular treatment that I trained with at university and have always used is more effective than acupuncture on this, or needling on this particular patient. You know, be prepared to say that. But if we do decide to needle, we're not necessarily saying we're going to do acupuncture. So acupuncture is a form of dry needling, but in terms of definition, acupuncture is involving points. Dry needling is not involving points, it's more an extension to manual therapy. So we don't have predefined points. And obviously the dry needling side we're going to be looking at later on the course. So after the first weekend, you know, you're not able to make that decision, but ultimately we will do. And if we just quickly go down this side, just so that we know what we're being prepared for. Dry needling itself can either be superficial, SDN, superficial dry needling, or deeper. And superficial dry needling works more on skin reflexes, muscle tone type things. Deeper dry needling does that, but it also has more of a direct mechanical effect. So essentially you're putting a piece of surgical steel into a tissue. That's going to change it. Once we do that, we've got a number of different effects. So one would be a mechanical effect, one would be a trigger point effect, and then we've also got skin reflex effects and periosteal effects. So we'll deal with that next in the second block. But in terms of acupuncture, again, we've got choices to make. So we could use a traditional Chinese medicine approach. Now, we haven't trained for that, so we're not going to use it, but that would involve diagnosis from a TCM perspective, which is essentially pulse diagnosis and tongue diagnosis. Now, we're not using that, but you have to be cautious that you're not sort of mixing and matching. And sometimes people can be a little bit guilty of this, and they'll say, well, you know, I'm using this because, you know, this point, and this point affected the trapezius and it affected the pain, etc., etc., and this one was for pathogenic cold. And you think, well, no, you know, you, that, that's how you know that there's pathogenic cold. If you do, and you've got some TCM knowledge, then that's fine. But TCM is simply a model to select the points. Okay? And I did a presentation some time ago, actually, for one of the AACP conferences, looking at low back pain and comparing the way that a TCM practitioner makes a diagnosis and chooses the points, and a Western medical acupuncturist does that. And we looked at some of the research, and the interesting thing is the points normally chosen are exactly the same. So it's purely the way you get to that decision. Okay. So you might say, well, I'm going to use bladder 23 because this patient has a pain around the L2 area. Somebody else might say, well, I'm using that because it's the back shoe point of the kidney. So the model that you've used to make that decision is different, but you're still using the same points.
Doesn't it depend on what mechanism you're trying to affect, Chris? Because I suppose if you use traditional Chinese medicine, you're trying to work on this concept of meridians, mm-hmm. and energy and a lot of people. If you're using Western medical acupuncture, you're trying to elicit local erythema and override pain mechanisms at the dorsal horn. They seem like very different.
The model is different, but the body that you're treating is exactly the same. So the effect that you have would be the same. So if you are stimulating something and you say, well, you know, there's erythema there, and then we've got an increase in blood flow, the TCM perspective would be to say, well, you've enhanced the qi flow. Now, qi flows in the meridians, but it also flows in the blood vessels. So the effect will be exactly the same, it's just the model which is different. It's a similar sort of thing to say, well, you know, are you, if you're using a traditional approach to low back pain, you say, well, you know, I'm using a McKenzie approach, or I'm using a CRX approach, or I'm using a Maitland approach, or whatever you use, you're still affecting the same tissues, and you're still aiming to get that patient better. So it's, again, it's just the model. And the McKenzie name is an interesting thing because it illustrates a similar sort of thing, whereas that is a model which isn't necessarily accurate. So, you know, movement of discal material and this type of stuff is a useful model, but it may not necessarily be, you know, 100% accurate. And the same with TCM. When we look at some of those things, these are historical models, but they may not be accurate in terms of, you know, a particular point in the lower back affecting the kidney organ and the kidney organ dominating bone, for example. So it's, you know, it's a mechanism or a method to select.
So you're affecting the same tissue, it just depends on what system of belief you want to use to explain what you're doing.
Yes, yeah, and the point that I'm making is that you need to use the system you're trained in. So if you haven't been trained in TCM, don't use it. As simple as that. And you know, that said, there are post-basic courses that you can do which will introduce you to TCM. And if, you know, if you choose to do that, then that's fine. What I wouldn't say is, you know, having done an AACP foundation course, you then need to go off and get a degree in acupuncture. Because those who have will turn around and tell you that actually, clinically, as a physiotherapist, it doesn't really help that much.
How is Western acupuncture different from traditional Chinese?
Well, Western acupuncture works on a Western medical diagnosis that we're using. TCM works on a traditional Chinese medicine model of medicine. So it uses, whereas we would use investigations such as MRI or X-ray, they would use tongue diagnosis, they would use pulse diagnosis.
Oh, right.
So their aim, we would say, well, look, this person has got shoulder impingement, that's a Western medical diagnosis. They would say, well, it's, you know, it's pathogenic cold invading the large intestine meridian. Yeah? So the what they're seeing is the same, but their model that they're working on is different. So they, in TCM, they try to identify a pathogen which is invading, they try to identify the meridian, and they try to identify the organ. Okay? Now, we are looking at the pain, the type of pain, and the stage of healing. So it's a slightly different thing. Okay, but within that Western medical sphere, again, we've got choices. So we can say, as I've just mentioned, what is the type of pain, what is the stage of healing, and therefore we can modify the treatment that we're using. So we say, well, okay, that tissue is irritable, so we're not going to needle directly in that. We're going to needle close by because we believe we're affecting dermatonally. Yeah? But equally, somebody else might say, well, no, we are going to use a protocol. Every patient who comes in with knee pain to this hospital department is going to be treated in this way. Now, you know, from a physio perspective, we would say that's very wrong. We're not, you know, we don't manipulate everybody's neck exactly the same way. We don't give the same exercises to every patient with the same pathology. However, from a research perspective, most studies are done with protocols. So in a way, if you're saying, well, look, we're going to be totally evidence-based, so we're only going to use those things which have been proven, well, you should be using the points that have been proven in that paper, shouldn't you? So, you know, if you're saying, well, look, this paper was really good and it treated arthritic knee pain, well, it only treated that with those points that were quoted in the paper. So there are benefits to protocols. But what I would say about protocol is it can be a starting point and it can be a guideline, and then we can progress on to there. Very much the case in the 1980s, 1970s, 1980s, you know, the Syriac's approach was very much like this, that, you know, you came out of college and you thought, how do I treat patients? And it gave you that framework of saying, well, look, selective tissue tension, is it a joint, is it a muscle, etc., etc. And then you progress on from that, but you can have that framework to start with. And so, just to say really that there are other approaches, and we mentioned the segmental approach yesterday, where we're not using points and meridians, we're just using dermatonal reference, and there are various different types of treatment within Western medical acupuncture. But essentially, what we're doing is we're going through that decision, that clinical decision-making process, rather than simply saying every patient who comes in with a tennis elbow, large intestine 11 and large intestine 4. Yeah. Okay. All right, so within the treatment timeline then, how long is this going to take? Because with the best will in the world, we are limited to the number of treatments that we can use and the treatment time that we have. Well, the advantage of dry needling is it's rapid. So with acupuncture, we're putting the needle in, we're leaving that needle in. With dry needling, we're often not, particularly if we're working at trigger points, we're trying to release that trigger point so the needle doesn't necessarily stay in. Now, there is overlap in that in some forms of dry needling, you use electrical stimulation, which is therefore very similar to acupuncture. Many people would argue that that side of dry needling is actually acupuncture. When it comes to leaving those needles in briefly, we mentioned yesterday that a weaker treatment would leave those needles in for about 10 or 15 minutes. Now, yes, that's a weak treatment, but what happens if you want to do a strong treatment, which is 40 minutes, and you are restricted to 15 minutes treatment? So if you're working in an NHS department where they say, well, look, you've got a maximum of 20 minutes, I probably wouldn't be choosing acupuncture to treat chronic pain, because we know that you do need a longer individual treatment and a greater number of treatments. So if you can't do that, then the chances are that the treatment's not going to be effective. And also, if you are leaving those needles in for 20 minutes, that's 20 minutes out of your treatment time. Now, if you've got 40 minutes, that might be fine. But if you've only got 20 minutes, there's a lot that you're not going to be doing, yeah, in terms of pain education, in terms of exercise. And we know that that's going to be more effective. So it's a question of, you know, choosing from that whole toolbox that you have as a physio, rather than just from the needle perspective. So briefly speaking, we said 15 to 20 minutes is average. Slightly less would be a weaker treatment. Slightly more would be a stronger treatment. And we can increase the strength of that treatment by needle stimulation, by leaving the needles in longer, and by doing treatments more often. So, you know, once a week, three times a week, every day. You know, that's going to strengthen things up. And that's purely from this perspective of saying, well, how many chemicals are we getting produced, and how long are those chemicals going to last, and the strength of that response.
Yeah. I've seen it work really well with, like, athletes. When, yeah, you know, yourself, the hardest thing is keeping up with the rigors of training, sure, day in, day out, sure, and they just get tight. And yeah. I've seen it used well, because it just helps them get over the pain and the discomfort, just to cope. It's just like a tool Because I've asked my senior, I said, oh, is it effective? And he just said it's a tool that you use and here's just one of your things that you might use.
Yes, absolutely. And I think the point of that is you say, well, okay, firstly, how is that achieving its effect? There will be a large amount of placebo, and that's not good or bad, it's just there. But the other thing, and I think the more important thing, is to say, well, what's the alternative? In terms of pain relief, the chances are that it's going to be drugs. Mm-hmm. So if it can reduce the requirement for drugs, I think that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. Now, I shared on Twitter that this thing about enhancing the inflammatory nature of using acupuncture to change salivary immunoglobulin and GGF, and that was done. It was done with some 36, but it was done with daily treatment, so quite a strong treatment. And again, you know, there has been work on upper respiratory tract infection, calming that down and making it less likely. Work on using vertical jump measurements and using trigger points to release fatigue in eccentric muscle work, so you know, fatiguing the muscle eccentrically and then needling afterwards and showing changes in vertical jump. So again, you know, it doesn't tell us the mechanism. You know, a person's been needled, they'd improved. Is it placebo? If we'd have done it with a sham needle, would it have been better or worse? We don't know. I mean, in some instances, it probably doesn't matter, but that's the same with many, many treatments, isn't it? That we, you know, it's very difficult to say, to distill it down to an individual intervention. Actually, what it is the total interaction. It's you and the patient and the environment and the treatment, the whole thing together. And if we take any element of that interaction and say, well, is it this intervention, this single intervention, the chances are it's going to fail.
You might be getting answers, but in terms of the evidence that's out there, which has shown it's effective in treating patients, how frequently are we treating them? Because obviously,
for injury or for prevention?
In terms of reduction in pain, if I get someone to come in and reduce pain, how often? I mean, because typically in NHS private sector, you're limited to seeing once a week, twice.
Sure. And it comes down to symptom modification. That there are the guideline, ultimately, would be to say, well, can you measure the blood chemicals? Because that would show you the response. And that has been done, but it's been done with electroacupuncture, and it's been done with TENS, so not so much manual acupuncture. Manual acupuncture on the whole is what we're using. And the average is to say, well, we need two or three treatments a week, you know, if we can get that. And the way that we judge that is purely through symptoms. That as that symptom relief starts to subside, you want to do the next treatment before it's gone completely. Right. So you want a certain amount of overlap, and that will depend on whether the reaction of the patient. So if I've got somebody who's elderly, their muscles are weak and they're slightly wasted, and they've got a chronic condition. Now, in Chinese medicine, that we would say that's more of a yin condition. In Western medicine, we would say that person is that's just run down. We want a strong treatment. Yeah. So a strong treatment in acupuncture would be, you know, more treatments, a greater number of amount of needle stimulation. But you could take that further and say, well, actually, what we want is a strong treatment in total. Yeah. So if we're trying to increase energies in inverted commas, well, we're doing that with exercise as well. So if you're saying to that person, look, I'm going to treat you once a week with acupuncture, but I'd like you to do these exercises twice a day, that's going to enhance them. Yeah. Chinese would say, well, that's also building up the qi. So our treatments as a physiotherapist are probably a lot more holistic than we would imagine. Because we are giving them advice on graded exposure, we are giving them exercises, and all of these things are working with the acupuncture.
I said not long ago to one of my colleagues about, you know, not necessarily CBT, but the language that you use, the interaction over intervention, and how by using positive verbal cues, you enhance the rehabilitative process. And I kind of got shouted down, saying, that's got no place in rehab, it's got no place here in particular, which I know is rubbish, because I've come back from serious injury myself.
Yeah.
And I think it is holistic, and I think sometimes We don't pay attention to
there is evidence to support that.
Yeah.
And we know that, you know, from a placebo perspective, we know how powerful placebo can be, and we know that that is enhanced by the environment and by the interaction. So the confident practitioner, the professional practitioner in the nice uniform, will give a better response in terms of placebo than the person who's doubtful and says, well, I'm not absolutely sure, etc., etc. So we do know that. And we also know from the perspective of pain, that chronic pain particularly, the interaction is probably more important than the intervention itself. So I would support you on that. Mm-hmm. And certainly from the perspective of things such as fatigue and motivation and overtraining, these sorts of things in sport, you know, that interaction is vital as well.
I've seen it, Chris, with
people, in terms of coaching.
They're sports therapy, some people are just really confident and say the right things and know how to relate to the athlete.
Yeah.
Turns them.
Yeah. Well, but also it's common sense, isn't it? If, you know, somebody's been knocked down in the road, there are lots of things you could come and say, well, you know, I've read this paper and it says this, that and the other. Well, they actually want a hand on the shoulder, you're going to be okay.
Yeah,
and that is being human. It's got nothing to do with research and evidence.
Yeah.
And I think that intuitive part of physiotherapy is sometimes really underestimated. Okay, so let's move on. So that's our treatment timeline then, and the pattern that we used was to say, well, we've got a local response when we put that needle in terms of the triple response in terms of the manipulation of the tissue. So that local response will determine that we can use local needles, but we would only do that if the tissue is not irritable. So if it is irritable, we're going to go close by. So we don't use just local points, we use local and or adjacent points. So if I've, and this is where the stage of healing and the pain comes in. So if I've got an acute injury, chances are I'm going to use a needle which is further away. So if I've got an ankle sprain, I'm not going to put the needle in the sprained ankle. I would choose a meridian above or below the area of the injury, and I would try to get chi to course through that area. Now you can argue that all you're doing is reversing some ischemia and increasing the blood flow. So, you know, when I say chi, that is just part of the model, isn't it? So we've got local and we've got adjacent points. We've then got distal points, and distal points can be along the meridian. We talked about source points and the power of points close to the hand and the foot in terms of the representation in the homunculus. But also we have these so-called empirical points, such as the influential points, gallbladder 34 that we mentioned yesterday, influential point for muscle and tendon, which have a whole body effect. And we looked yesterday in terms of the pain physiology, and we say, well, you know, diffuse noxious inhibitory control from the brainstem is a whole body effect. It is going to calm the system down and reduce pain, not in the injured knee, in the injured body. Yeah. So again, these patterns of, you know, a local effect, you could say, well, is that an effect at the dorsal horn? A distal effect, is that an effect at the brain stem? The total effect, is that higher centre? Yeah? So we've got a variety of different models that we can parallel with this. Okay, so I've got some different examples, and we've used quite a few of these. So if we were using large intestine 15 in the shoulder, we say, well, we want to use a distal point. Now, in theory, any point on the hand would be powerful in terms of the homunculus. But because we're on the large intestine channel, it would be better to choose a large intestine point. And again, we've got several large intestine points in the hand. It just so happens that large intestine 4 is one of the most powerful points. Now, it's a source point in Chinese medicine, but it's also inside a thumping great big muscle, and we're going to get a lot of wind up in that area. So we can use that. If I'm not able to use that local point because the area is too painful, or because it's difficult perhaps to get the needle into that position, I can use an adjacent point. So large intestine 14 is the point at the insertion of the deltoid. So it's within the same dermatome, it's adjacent to the first one, but it's not in the injured tissue. Okay? Take an example of our lung. We can say, well, large intestine 11 was a typical point that we could use for tennis elbow. Support that with large intestine 4. If we can't use large intestine 11, we can use something close by. So I can go up to large intestine 12, or I can go down to large intestine 10, or I can come across onto the lung channel, which is going to be close to that area. So I've got a choice of different points, and we can go through these in a similar way, and we'll come on to some of these later. We mentioned the low back yesterday, and we did some of those points. So we're just using this model to say, well, how are we going to select the points for our first treatment? And once we've done that, how are we going to progress that treatment? And the progression, of course, will depend on how the patient has reacted. So if you've used 3 needles and the patient hasn't reacted particularly well, in that you haven't had the immediate dirty, they haven't had the pain relief response, between the treatments, what are you going to do next time? Would you increase the number of needles, or would you reduce the number of needles? Or how would you change that treatment if they had a poor response?
Increase.
Yeah, so we want a stronger stimulus, don't we? So a stronger stimulus would be more needles, or you might say, well, I used manual acupuncture last time, this time I'm going to use electroacupuncture, or I gently flicked the needles last time because it was your first treatment, this time I'm going to wind that needle up. So we're strengthening that treatment. In the same way as if you were giving some form of exercise, and you said, well, okay, you did a squat last time, and I thought that would cause quite a lot of muscle aching. I actually didn't feel it at all. So this time, let's use a slightly heavier weight, or yet use the same weight and slow it down so it's acting for longer, or let's do a greater range of motion, etc., etc. So we're increasing that load on the muscle. Okay. So let's have a look at a couple of examples then. So here we've got 35-year-old male with low back pain referred to the right buttock and into the posterior thigh. So, I'm using this as an acupuncture example, knowing that, we've already done a physiotherapy examination. So that's showing us then that it's along the bladder meridian. So if it went on the front of the leg, it's more likely to be your yang channel, so it might be stomach, for example. But if it's the back of the leg, it's going to be your bladder. So it's still the yang channel, but we know that we've got the stomach, we've got the gallbladder, and the bladder to choose from. That's going on the back of the leg, so it's more like it's brought on by gardening, so repeated flexion, 3 weeks duration, so it's not going to be hyperacute. So we'll confirm that with our examination of the whole patient. Straight leg raise, 70 degrees, no red flags, and again, that would be part of our physio examination. Worse with sitting and driving, better with walking. So, what we're going to try to do then is we're going to try to get them to do a rehab program. Then we know that we want to start on a rehab program, we want to try to centralize that pain, and it's likely that avoiding flexion will do that. Getting that spine to move, or getting the body to move, just with general walking will help, and getting the spine to move will help as well. So in theory, we could treat that without acupuncture. But if we're looking at using acupuncture, we say, well, okay, how's that going to fit in? If we can reduce the pain, they're going to have less pain inhibition, they're going to be more willing to exercise. So the exercise itself will be more effective because we're reducing pain inhibition. And secondly, it will be more effective because we're increasing patient compliance. Because it's going to be difficult for an individual to exercise if they're not an athlete, if they're not used to sort of, the pain that these things will cause. They're going to be saying, well, it hurts me. I went to see this physiotherapist and they gave me these exercises, but it hurts when I do it. So if we can reduce some of that pain, in parallel with re-educating them, and we can say, well, look, hurt is not equivalent to harm, and we are as you're exercising, you will feel this in your back, you will feel us working those tissues, and that's a good thing. So don't feel that when you're exercising, if you've got pain, that you need to stop. And we're going to try to target that pain. Okay, so we're going to choose some local points. Why are we